Recorded Books presents Lady Joker, Volume 2 by Kaoru Takamura. Translated from the Japanese by Maria Iida and Allison Markin Powell. Narrated by Brian Nishii. Part 4. Summer, 1995. The Threat. Chapter 1. Haruhisa Kubo. It was before 12.02 a.m. on May 8th, shortly after Kubo had returned from his check-in for the evening session, when he got a heads-up from the first mobile investigation unit. His source, the assistant police inspector, said in a quick whisper, "Lady Joker's on the move. They've demanded 600 million in cash." "Lady what?" Kubo grabbed a notepad that was nearby. The assistant inspector repeated the English words. "Lady as in First Lady, then Joker as in the trump card. Lady Joker. That's what the crime group is calling themselves." Kubo passed around the notepad on which he had scribbled Hinode suspects equals Lady Joker to his colleagues in the press nook, then resumed firing questions into the receiver. "Was the demand made with a letter or over the phone?" "A sealed letter, in a business envelope. It was thrown inside the front gate of their Kyoto factory this morning."
"What time was it discovered?"
5:30 a.m. A guard found it."
"What did it say? Please."
"They want 600 million in used bills. The handoff will take place at 11 p.m. on the 9th. A white station wagon will be used to transport the money. Only one person in the car. Location will be somewhere in Kyoto district. That's all I can tell you."
"Where will the car leave from? The main office? A branch office? A factory? We can tail it."
"That's the best I can do. Sorry." His source cut off there, but Kubo could guess that the white station wagon with the payload would leave from either Hinode's main office, its Tokyo branch, Yokohama branch, or the Kanagawa factory, and they'd know which if they staked out all the possible locations. So long as it took place within the city limits of Tokyo's 23 districts, the driver would only be able to go so fast on local streets or the highway, making it possible for them to tail the vehicle if they knew which one it was.
"Yes, yes!"
Kuriyama shouted. Chief Sugano was barking orders without missing a beat.
"I'll contact the Metro Chief. Kubo, you work on the advance articles. Kuriyama and Kondo, you guys assemble the beat reporters, and Kagawa-kun, have a car ready so we can tail them."
Thus, in the moments before the deadline for the final morning edition, the MPD press nook was suddenly galvanized. Even as they spread the roadmap of Kyoto District and began to determine stakeout positions near Hinode's main office and branch offices, they fixated on the peculiarity of that name, Lady Joker.
"Sounds like what they'd call one of those local racehorses."
"Nah, a video game." "No, no, a female pro wrestler."
Despite these quips, the name boggled their imaginations. A female Joker of all things. The following morning, the 9th, at the regular press conference, the chief inspector of first investigation spoke only about developments in their interrogation of leaders of the religious cult and their involvement in the subway poison gas terror attack, and there was no sign from the rival papers that they had gotten hold of any leads related to Hinode. Before noon, taking stock of information gathered from their reporters staked out at the various locations, the news crew determined that the highest number of unmarked police cars were deployed in the area around Hinode's Tokyo branch office in Nishishinjuku, and deduced that it must be the starting point. Working backward from the designated hour of 11 p.m., the time of departure would be shortly after 10 at the earliest. There being no hostage, it was unlikely that Hinode would use real bills, and given that this was the first money exchange, it was possible that the perpetrators themselves would be testing the waters, but it was certain that the police had surrounded the place with a substantial net. After sundown, a number of backup reserve and beat reporters began patrolling the major roads within Kyoto District on motorcycles or in private cars, searching for unmarked police investigation vehicles or two-wheelers that might be positioned for pursuit of the perpetrators. Their hunt for police investigation vehicles did not produce any hits, but at 10:25 p.m., as predicted, a reporter on stakeout confirmed that a white station wagon drove out of the parking lot of the Tokyo branch office. Kubo received this call while in a hired vehicle en route to the official residence of the Chief Inspector of First Investigation in Himonya. The driver was alone, a man, wearing a sleeveless undershirt. The reporter said there was no way to know whether the man was a detective or not. If the unseasonal sleeveless undershirt had been a directive of the perpetrators, then they must have been on guard against the wireless radio that cops wore beneath their jackets. Inside the car tailing the white station wagon was Kubo's colleague Kuriyama, wearing glasses that he normally did not wear. They needed someone with at least a passing knowledge of the police investigation who would be able to distinguish the vehicles and motorcycles of the recently deployed SIT teams, as well as recognize the faces of members of the mobile investigation unit deployed to the first and second lines. At 10:48 p.m., Kubo received word that the station wagon had been steadily making its way toward, then had crossed, the Shin Ohashi Bridge over the Sumida River. Once across that bridge, the landscape shifted. They were now in Koto District, a jumble of cheap wooden apartments, decrepit buildings, ryokans barely discernible from residential houses, small steel factories, warehouses, stores, and the like, intersected by layers of industrial roads running north, south, east, and west. During the day, rows of desolate gray homes, seemingly frozen in time, could be seen along the industrial roads clogged with trucks and commercial traffic headed toward Chiba. But in the depths of night, aside from the scant roadside illumination from convenience stores, family restaurants, and vending machines, the entire area would be steeped in darkness, as if awash with ink. Kubo was able to imagine the scene there now, and the parade of headlights by reeling in his memories of the locales he had scrounged around in his 10 years as a reporter. He knew just what kind of place the station wagon carrying the payload was moving through now. 12 minutes left until the time specified by the perpetrators. At this time of night, it would take less than 10 minutes to drive straight through Koto District. Where was the station wagon headed? Kubo's hired car had just turned into a side street off Megurodori Avenue, but before making his way toward the official residence, Kubo at least wanted to figure out the station wagon's destination, so he remained inside the car, awaiting word. At 11:02 p.m., Chief Sugano called from the press nook. "The station wagon has entered the parking lot of the Skylark restaurant just in front of Nishii Ojima Station. What appear to be two unmarked MPD motorcycles are nearby." It only took 4-5 minutes to go straight from Shin Ohashi Bridge to Nishii Ojima. The station wagon had apparently adjusted for time along the way and had then pulled into the Skylark parking lot. As family restaurants in industrial areas far from nightlife centers always tended to be, the Skylark restaurant would no doubt be crowded with young local couples, and inside, SIT detectives posing as some of those couples must now have their eyes trained on the parking lot. Where would the SIT and mobile units' riders, specially trained in pursuit, be waiting astride their 400cc bikes? The parking lot? The shoulder of the road? Or in a nearby alley? There was no way that the perpetrators would suddenly appear, so undoubtedly they'd have the station wagon move on to yet another spot. Where will the next destination be? Feeling his blood pressure creeping up, Kubo told the chief, "I've got to see Kanzaki now, so I'll leave you to it," and dashed out of his hired car. These last 4 days of the Golden Week holiday, the chief of first investigation had received reporters for the regular evening interview sessions, seemingly out of stubbornness, and again tonight he had returned to his official residence, feigning nonchalance to deflect the media's attention. Yet, by the time Kubo rushed up to join the reporters, the line that normally assembled by company along the alley in front of the official residence after 10 p.m. had already dispersed, save for the reporters from two commercial broadcasting companies. "You're awful late tonight," the network reporter at the end of the line said, throwing a skeptical look at Kubo. "My car got into a fender bender," Kubo replied with forced sulkiness as he stood in the alley darkness. He had to keep his head down to hide the excitement that was no doubt evident on his face. 10 minutes later, Kubo was the last person to enter the drawing room of the official residence, where he came face to face with the chief inspector of first investigation. Kanzaki appeared without his suit jacket on and was not even seated in his usual armchair. He came right out with it.
The accident with your hired car is a lie, isn't it? Well, sure.
Kubo let the question go and instead got quickly to the point. More importantly, about the Lady Joker case. Kanzaki cast a withering glance as he sat down in his chair.
You have 5 minutes. Chief Inspector, the crime group after Hinode is calling themselves Lady Joker, are they not?
We haven't confirmed whether that is their name.
I heard that a letter demanding 600 million was delivered to the Kyoto factory yesterday morning.
I neither deny nor confirm that.
About 40 minutes ago, a white station wagon left Hinode's Tokyo branch office in Shinjuku, and just now, the station wagon arrived at a certain place in the middle of Koto District.
As far as the police force is concerned, to print such things in a newspaper would amount to a malicious obstruction of our investigation. Besides, no matter how you were to write about it, there would be no way to avoid its having a negative impact on Hinode's business activities. Freedom of the press only reaches so far.
If a cash demand has been made, it would dispel rumors of any backroom deals, and so writing about it might not seem like negative press for Hinode.
Backroom deals and whatnot are concerns of the investigation and the media. The fact that the case has not come to an end is what causes an overreaction by the consumers and in the share price.
You mean the case will not end with tonight's money exchange?
I'm not saying that at all. Hinode is fully cooperating with the police investigation now, and supposing that a cash demand were to be made, apprehending the crime group would be our highest priority. I do not condone any act that would interfere with such efforts.
There would be no obstruction if I wrote about it after the money exchange took place. Both consumers and investors have a right to know the facts as soon as possible. I'm putting it in the morning edition.
Reporting it in the paper could trigger an unexpected reaction from the suspects. Knowing that, would you still write about it?
Kanzaki asked and glanced at the clock, confirming that it was 11:19 p.m.
In any case, in order to provide for any contingencies, I would like for you to wait until after midnight, he murmured.
In that moment, Kubo became utterly convinced that the money exchange was still in progress, that the transport vehicle was headed elsewhere from Skylark, and that the perpetrators had not yet appeared.
By unexpected reaction, do you mean a development that could affect more human lives is anticipated?
It means I cannot speak about a situation that hasn't produced an outcome. How about we call your press nook after midnight and say whether or not it's okay? That'll be all for tonight.
As Kanzaki broke off the conversation and rose from his chair, he looked distracted, without even the presence to look Kubo in the face. Kubo surmised that now Kanzaki would either head back to Sakuradamon or pay a visit to Special Investigation Headquarters. At 11:24 p.m., Kubo called the MPD press nook as soon as he jumped back into his hired car. He was told that, on the scene in Koto District, the cash transport vehicle was on the move. After arriving at Skylark at precisely 11 p.m., the station wagon had not moved at all until 11:15 p.m. when it left the parking lot, getting back on Shin Ohashidori Avenue and traveling 600 meters east. The vehicle appeared to stop in front of the Ojima Rokuchome intersection. Then the driver got out of the car and went into a telephone booth on the sidewalk. Apparently, it was impossible to see the driver's detailed movements from a distance, but he came out of the booth within less than a minute, got back in the station wagon, and then turned right at the intersection. The vehicle continued south for 1.2 kilometers, this time turning left onto Kiyosubashidori Avenue. After going about 200 meters, the station wagon stopped again in front of the Kitasuna Nanachome overpass. Turned left into a blind alley. The unmarked MPD motorcycle that had been tailing the station wagon came to a stop in front of the overpass without turning left. This kept Kuriyama and those with him from getting any closer. A plainclothes detective ordered them to stop just as they pulled onto the shoulder of the road. This was at 11:21 p.m. Next, there had been another call saying that at 11:22 p.m., just as Kuriyama and his men were about to leave the scene following the detective's orders, they saw the man in the sleeveless undershirt driving a navy van that pulled out from the alley in front of the overpass. It seemed the perpetrators had made them load the cash into a different vehicle. If the perpetrators were checking whether the police were tailing them by successively switching up the transport vehicle, then Kubo sensed that there was a 50-50 chance they would actually show up for the cash grab, but the end result no longer mattered to him. There was not much they would be able to write about for the final morning edition anyway, but the name alone, Lady Joker, was sufficiently newsworthy to be splashed in a banner headline across the top of the front page. It was sensational enough, and the article would build anticipation for further developments. As he pondered this, the excitement Kubo had felt over the last 24 hours built to an almost visceral pleasure, and his body continued to shake as the hired car carried him along. The call from Chief Inspector Kanzaki came at 5 after midnight, once Kubo was already back at the press nook.
"Kubo-san, the suspects were a no-show," came the chief's glum voice. "What was the station wagon's final destination, and when did it arrive there?"
"Komatsugawa 4丁目.
They stopped along the embankment, beneath the Komatsugawa Bridge. They arrived at 11:31.
By the way, I hope you're prepared to be punished accordingly for your attempt to track us. That's all."
5 minutes after the phone call, Chief Sugano, finishing a different call, laughed and said,
"We got quite the chewing out from the head of criminal investigation. Forget about it. Just keep going."
It was a rare sight to see Sugano smile. Kyosuke Shiroyama. At 6 a.m. on May 10th, Shiroyama retrieved the 3 morning newspapers from the letterbox outside his home and discovered the unpostmarked business envelope that was also slipped inside. The envelope looked the same as the one he had found on his lawn 2 days earlier. This time, he waited until he was back inside and opened it in the front hall.
"Are you keeping the 600 million safe? A second demand will be made soon. Have the president call 3751-921X between 9 p.m. and 9:05 p.m. on the 10th. If you don't want the hostage to die, don't let the police know about this letter. Lady Joker."
Without giving too much thought to the contents of the letter, Shiroyama put the envelope in his pocket for the time being. Later, in the living room, he opened the morning paper and saw the banner headline on the front page.
"Suspects claim alias Lady Joker. Demand 600 million. Hinode Beer President's kidnappers make a move."
The article consisted of a lead of no more than 200 characters, followed by a concise main paragraph of about 50 lines, summarizing the full version of events, beginning with the discovery of the letter the day before yesterday up to the money exchange last night, and concluding with the following.
"The police investigation is forced to consider a new response given the movements of the crime group in probably attempting a cash grab without a hostage."
In an effort to remain as mentally and physically stable as possible, Shiroyama had entrusted the control room with handling all matters related to the incident. Nevertheless, the protective barrier around his mind was far from impenetrable. Upon seeing the front page of a national paper plastered with a story about last night's money exchange, which he had hoped would be carried out without rousing any sensation, what he felt at first was shock, followed by an indiscriminate rage, and once he realized there was no place to direct his fury, he was flummoxed. The logic and resolve he had taken for granted began to waver again, and an incoherent anxiety swelled inside him. Shiroyama then probed, with relentless precision, the reasons for his unsettled mind and was again forced to acknowledge that many of them stemmed from Hinode and himself. Besides the letter that Hinode had reported to the police, he had shown the other letter that had been thrown onto his lawn on the morning of the 8th to the 2 vice presidents, as well as the head of general affairs and the financial manager, before storing it inside the safe in his office. Once Hinode had followed the criminal's instructions, "If you don't want the hostage to die, don't let the police know about this letter," the company itself was preventing any progress in the situation, thwarting the chance of arresting the criminals. This was the road they had chosen. To sit there as last night's events unfolded, it had been a cheap trick from the start, waiting helplessly for the criminal's next move, all the while fearing for the safety of the hostage. Shiroyama himself would not be able to escape the fate of endlessly brooding over whether he had been right or wrong in his decision not to alert the police about the letter tossed onto his lawn. And then this morning, here was another letter. He knew he would end up complying with the criminal's demand to make whatever that call was tonight. Despite his absorption with these thoughts, Shiroyama was not so confused as to lose sight of the practical steps necessary to arrange. As long as his attention to day-to-day affairs kept him occupied down to the minute, the fact of the matter was that he had no time for confusion, and the actions Shiroyama took that morning were as swift and businesslike as ever, the result of his seemingly programmed capacity to manage at all times under any circumstances. As soon as he arrived at the office at 8:30 a.m., without even looking at the documents prepared on his desk, Shiroyama called in the finance director to instruct him to monitor any fluctuations in their stock price and to notify him at once should market conditions shift. Next, Shiroyama called in Kurata to discuss the immediate measures they would take, making sure that the beer division's special promotions department had implemented their market research and that the sales department worked to strengthen their distribution network. He then met with the public relations director and came to the conclusion that, in response to the media, it would suffice to send a fax to each company conveying the following. In light of Hinode's full cooperation with the police investigation, they would refrain from making any comments. In addition, Shiroyama directed the manager of general affairs assigned to the control room to demand an explanation from the chief inspector of first investigation why the criminals had not shown up last night, even though Hinode had followed their instructions. The criminals' failure to appear was not a problem in and of itself. What Shiroyama wanted to know was how the police viewed last night's money exchange and whether or not they had considered it a charade all along. And finally, Shiroyama called Iwami at the Commissioner General's office of the NPA and registered a token complaint, demanding to know what had gone wrong with the police force's management of information. Iwami expressed perfunctory regret while responding that it was impossible to muzzle the press unless a person's life was at stake, as in a kidnapping. Once he had dispatched these items, Shiroyama looked over the daily reports submitted from each division, booted up his desktop computer, and checked his personal electronic mail. He had received one from Shirai, one from Kotani at their risk management company, another from the president of Limelight Japan, and one each from the presidents of Hinode's London and New York subsidiaries. Shiroyama composed and sent short replies to them all, then and there. There was no time to peruse the file of industry news article clippings. By the time he slipped the documents that his secretary, Miss Nozaki, had prepared into his briefcase and stood to leave, it was 9:20 a.m. His first destination that morning was the Japan Business Federation. As Shiroyama stepped out of his office, Goda, though the name on his employee badge read Tanaka, rose from a chair near Miss Nozaki's desk. Goda was expected to remain in that spot while Shiroyama was at his desk. According to Miss Nozaki, Goda was always reading a paperback, though perhaps he was listening for Shiroyama's footsteps on the rug in the next room, since Goda always put the book away before Shiroyama opened the door, and Goda would already be standing by the time Shiroyama emerged. "The car is waiting by the front entrance," Miss Nozaki reminded them.
"Thank you," Goda responded.
Then he opened the door for Shiroyama, stepping aside to let him through. Goda always spoke in a soft, low voice. His behavior was well-trained, the way he opened and closed doors and got in and out of vehicles, the way he followed three paces behind Shiroyama, the way he kept his gaze downcast and bowed to other executives and people outside the company. He had so far managed to keep track of the schedule provided by Miss Nozaki. Goda was always at attention, never letting down his guard, from the time he picked Shiroyama up in the morning to when they parted at night. By the third day, Shiroyama had begun to acclimate to his presence, but still, it was like having a handsome and meticulous imperial guard of his own. As far as Shiroyama could tell, however, under his apparent neutrality, Goda's eyes displayed subtle shades of darkness, wondering what that prudent gaze saw, three steps behind him, made Shiroyama feel if not uncomfortable, then at least unsettled. From Goda's outward appearance or manner, Shiroyama had no inkling whether he had seen Shiroyama pick up the envelope on his lawn the day before yesterday, that morning when they first met. Just this very morning, in the car on the way to the office, Shiroyama had tried to trick him into talking about it by musing why the criminals had not appeared, but Goda, with a momentary pause, merely replied,
"I've been instructed only to act as your guard, sir."
Shiroyama handed Goda his briefcase and walked through the lobby and out the front entrance to the covered driveway. Goda's arm moved swiftly to open the car door, and Shiroyama climbed in. The door closed. Goda walked around to the opposite side and got in next to him.
"Shall I head directly to the Japan Business Federation?" the driver asked.
"Yes, please," Goda responded.
Goda was now the one who conducted these exchanges with Yamazaki, the driver. Yesterday morning, when Yamazaki had confirmed the destination, Shiroyama had been lost in thought and forgot to reply, so Goda had answered in his stead, thereby establishing a new precedent, one that was fine by Shiroyama. Shiroyama took no notice of Goda and Yamazaki's brief exchange as he shifted his eyes toward the new green leaves tinting the promenade in front of their main office building and focused on calming his nerves, roiled as they were by the article in the morning edition. He only wished his eyes and his mind could be rinsed clean by the verdant freshness before him. Fumiaki Negoro. Following the regular press conference at 11 a.m., during which the MPD unexpectedly divulged a great number of details related to last night's attempted cash seizure, the third and subsequent editions of May 10th's evening paper included multiple articles that needed to be overhauled for both page one and the metro pages, and Negoro's desk all but exploded with the onslaught of new drafts. Toho's scoop, which the morning edition had made plain with the name Lady Joker, was an undeniable coup. First of all, the police released a copy of the actual letter contained in a business envelope that was said to have been found and retrieved by a security guard inside the front gate of Hinode's Kyoto factory at 5:30 a.m. on May 8th. Both the stationery and the handwriting were said to be the same as that of the letter retrieved from Mr. Shiroyama's front yard when he was abducted on March 24th. The contents of the letter, which was to be the lead article for the evening edition, "Make sure this goes on the front page," Tabe, the slot editor, had ordered, read as follows. "Prepare 600 million in used bills in two cardboard boxes and load them into a white station wagon. Designate a single male driver, one with expertise of the roads. Must be dressed in a sleeveless undershirt and jeans. No jacket or hat. Have him carry a cellular phone. On May 9th, 11 p.m., drive the station wagon along Shin Ohashidori Avenue to the parking lot of Skylark Restaurant, across from the Koto District Residence Center, and await further instructions. Instructions will be sent to CSHND. Lady Joker." Quite matter-of-fact in its tone, the text did not make any specific threats whatsoever. The majority opinion within the Metro section was that a threat must have been made elsewhere, separately, that XYZ would happen if orders were not followed, but the truth was still unknown. The evening edition, which included the contents of the letter, ran with this front-page headline: "Mystery of Lady Joker deepens. Puzzling ransom demand without hostage." Nevertheless, a clearer portrait had emerged of the perpetrators as well-versed in police investigations. From their specification that the driver wear clothes that would make it difficult to conceal communication equipment, such as a wireless police radio, to their use of the expression "expertise of the roads" and their method of moving the station wagon to deter police deployment, and the detailed account of the late-night money exchange that transpired on the 9th corroborated such a portrayal. The Metro headline in the fourth edition read, "Perps show deep knowledge of investigation methods. Foil police with minute-by-minute instructions." The Metro page also displayed photos of the four sites that were the setting for the money exchange drama. A panoramic view of the run-of-the-mill family restaurant along Sangyo Road, and the telephone booth with its old-fashioned red roof located not far away just before the intersection. The blind alley before the overpass that looked like a garbage dump. The deserted three-way junction beneath the elevated bridge along the Arakawa River embankment. And finally, the triangle mark drawn on the asphalt in white chalk. And a map extract of Koto District with each site marked with an X. At 11 p.m. on the 9th, the station wagon carrying two cardboard boxes with the 600 million entered the parking lot of Skylark Restaurant as instructed and waited. At 11:14 p.m., an email came in to CSHND, the computer communication system used by Hinode Beer's customer service center. Inside the telephone booth in front of the Ojima Rokuchome intersection, there is a letter under the telephone. Read it and follow the instructions. The police had contacted Hinode's network provider and the telephone company, NTT, ahead of time and set up a program that automatically traced the phone number of every sender who accessed the system at any time during the course of the day on the 9th. The Hinode main office immediately contacted the station wagon's driver on a cellular phone and relayed the message. The station wagon left Skylark at 11:15 p.m. and a minute later had parked on the shoulder of the road by the designated phone booth. The letter, retrieved by the driver from under the telephone inside the booth, was in the same handwriting and on the same stationery as the one from the morning of the 8th. A vehicle with the license plate RA318X is parked in the alley next to Nippon Rent-A-Car on Kiyosubashidori Avenue before the Kitasuna Nanachome overpass. The driver should transfer the cardboard boxes and switch vehicles following Kiyosubashidori all the way to the end, then turn left. Drive along the embankment, pulling up just before the Onagi River floodgates and wait for the main office to call. Must arrive by 11:25 p.m. The station wagon arrived at the designated alley at 11:20 p.m. The vehicle with the license plate RA318X was a Navy van, a Toyota Hiace. The van came with a duplicated key and was later determined to be stolen. The driver transferred the cardboard boxes to the van and started driving again at 11:22 p.m. The van arrived in front of the floodgates at 11:26 p.m., 1 minute later than instructed. 1 minute earlier, at 11:25 p.m., CSHND had received a second message. After passing under the Komatsugawa Bridge, there will be a white triangle mark on the road. The driver should stop the car there and walk under the overpass in the direction of the shopping district. Abandon the van by 11:30 p.m. When the main office called the driver's cell phone to relay these instructions, there was a delay caused by poor reception, so the van didn't arrive at the designated location beneath the Komatsugawa Bridge until 11:31 p.m. The driver confirmed that there was a triangle on the road, drawn in white chalk with each side about 50 centimeters long. Then he left the car and started walking in the direction of the shopping district. The investigation team kept watch over the area for about 30 minutes and, with still no sign of the suspects, they recovered the van and the cash just past midnight on the 10th. At the morning press conference on the 10th, Chief Inspector Kanzaki of First Investigation stated, "Late at night, there were no other cars on Route 449, a one-way road that runs high along the Arakawa River embankment, so it was difficult to tail the cash transport vehicle without being noticed by the suspects, who were likely surveilling from nearby." The site in question, beneath the Komatsugawa Bridge, off of Route 449, was a desolate three-way junction surrounded by one-way alleys. And for a tail vehicle to reach it from the direction of Higashisuna while avoiding the van's route on 449 would have required a major detour. As for why the suspects never appeared, possibilities considered by Special Investigation Headquarters include that the perpetrators intended it to be a trial run from the beginning, or that they aborted the plan once the van did not arrive at the specified time. But it cannot be denied that the suspects led the police on a wild goose chase with their cleverly devised down-to-the-minute instructions. It was determined that the two messages sent to CSHND originated from different sources. Special Investigation Headquarters deem it highly probable that both sources had their passwords stolen and were subsequently used by their perpetrators. This was followed by a comment from Hinode Beer's main office. President Shiroyama did not respond to a personal request for comment. On the morning of the 10th, the Public Relations Department of Hinode Beer sent the following message via fax to all news outlets. Hinode has fully entrusted the investigation to the police and will refrain from making any comments at this time. Followed by quotes from various pundits. A social criminologist.
Reflecting the lingering economic downturn and pervasive dark mood of the times, corporate extortion methods have grown increasingly sinister and extreme. The time has come for corporations to seriously consider installing westernized risk management systems, and police must also implement new investigative techniques as soon as possible to counter this new crime strain.
A criminal psychologist.
The meticulousness of their method and the unlikelihood of success, both are consistent with criminals who have a tendency to take pleasure in the crime itself. It is plausible that a crime group attempting a ransom without a hostage derives a perverse enjoyment from challenging their victim, the corporation, as well as the police.
A social critic.
The cash demand that followed the president's abduction seems more significant than a crime merely aimed at a corporation. It's improbable that Hinode alone would be the target of such relentless harassment, and the sum of 600 million is haphazard as well. Perhaps the police have yet to grasp the full truth of the incident.
Amid these expert opinions, a certain critic had also remarked,
I'd like to lay eyes on a company that would comply with a cash demand without a hostage. No doubt there's a different backstory between Hinode and the crime group than what's been made public.
The slot editor, however, declined to print this comment. A filler article, Temporary Sell-Off in Hinode Shares, reported,
Following the news this morning that suspects have attempted to extort 600 million in cash from Hinode Beer, the Tokyo Stock Exchange saw a wave of stock selling before the afternoon, mainly by private investors averse to risks from the company's activity. Meanwhile, there were buy orders as well, and Hinode's turnover for the morning amounted to 200,000 shares. Morning trading ended with a minor decrease of 20 yen from yesterday's closing price. But Hinode's business is robust, and experts predict that their overall performance will remain steady going forward.
And, a related sidebar, MPD sets up dedicated hotline. After the attempted extortion of 600 million yen from Hinode Beer on the 10th, the Metropolitan Police Department established a 24-hour phone line to gather information from the public. MPD is seeking information from anyone who witnessed suspicious individuals or vehicles near the telephone booth at the intersection in front of Ojima Station, Koto District, by the Kitasuna Nanachome Overpass, along Route 449, or near Komatsugawa Bridge, Komatsugawa Yonchome. Contact the Hinode Beer Case Clerk at MPD, Omori Police Department, at this toll-free number 0120-46812X. At 1:30 in the afternoon, Negoro took a break to gather up the mountain of rejected and swapped-out drafts littering his desk. He sipped the bancha green tea he could not remember brewing as he chewed on a piece of dried sour kelp, and was just sorting through the drafts when someone called out, Negoro-san, call for you! He picked up the phone and heard the voice of Tomohiko Okabe, the securities man. Ever since their reunion in Shinbashi right after Shiroyama's abduction, Okabe had frequently passed along detailed reports on the exchange's blotter and the sources of speculative stock deals. Just last month, not exactly in return, but to keep up the relationship, Negoro had purchased about 2,000 shares, choosing more stable issues with a good dividend yield. Negoro was wondering why Okabe was calling now, just as the afternoon trading session had begun, when Okabe said abruptly,
I'm sending over a fax right now. I want you to take a look.
And the hold music came on. Negoro also put the call on hold and rose from his seat, waiting for about a minute in front of the two fax machines that were nearby. He soon held a sheet of A4-sized paper that one of the machines had spit out, but he couldn't make any sense of it at first, the letters too small to read, so he brought it back to his seat. He spread the page out in front of him to take another look, and saw that it was some sort of index of associates. Instead of names, the members were indicated by numbers, each listing the company and the department where they worked, for a total of 30 members. The first 18 were all employees at securities companies of various size, including the major one where Okabe worked. The remaining 12 entries were a strange list of company names written out in katakana and Western acronyms, and these Negoro had to look through twice. Member number 24 belonged to GSC Limited. 2 weeks ago, when he had looked up GSC Limited in the register at the Legal Affairs Bureau, he had learned that its official trade name was General Stock Chronicle Limited. The company had been founded in October 1990. Its activities were listed as investments, management consulting services, and magazine publications. Takeshi Kikuchi was listed as a founder, along with four others named Kikuchi, who seemed to be his relatives. There were four more names, all of whom were represented by Takeshi Kikuchi. The company's capital was 10 million yen. The registered location of the company was Iidabashi in Chiyoda District. Negoro had paid a visit to the address, a room on the third floor of a shabby office building, and though there was a sign on the door, there was no indication that the mailbox was being used. Peering through the keyhole, he saw that the room was empty. All along, Negoro had suspected GSC Limited might be a shell company, but he would never have imagined that its name would turn up like this today. Negoro's hand shook a little as he picked up the receiver again.
Okabe-san, I saw the fax. I was drinking in Shinbashi yesterday and I met the broker who's number 10 on that list. He's the one who gave me that index. Do you know what it's for?
No.
A kind of network, if you will. We're talking about thugs. As a matter of fact, I was asked to join them. Apparently, that's how low I've sunk.
Okabe spoke with a slight languid drawl, as if making an effort to sound as he usually did, but the substance of what he was saying blatantly reeked.
Surely you've heard of it before, Negoro-san. An investor partners up with a friend at a brokerage and, say, I had shares that I failed to sell before the price dropped. My broker friend has his own clients put in buy orders so that I can unload them.
I've heard stories about groups that try to manipulate deals in that way.
You could say they're descendants of those groups. The guy who recruited me didn't say what exactly this crew was doing, but if this number of brokers band together, they can move 5-6 million shares a day. I bet even more if there are investment trusts. They can manipulate deals as much as they want, even generate wealth for particular customers, while the members themselves make standard commissions plus a little extra on the side.
Negoro tried to imagine this as the explanation for the sudden increase in Hinode stock transactions since April, but it still didn't click for him. It wasn't so rare for individual brokers or for a single company or branch to commit a one-off swindle, but if you could take your pick of contacts among myriad securities companies and then link up with any one of these finance companies and investment groups, all manner of crookery could easily be absorbed into routine day-to-day trading.
So how did this number 10 recruit you? Negoro asked. Well, he just asked if I could put in a buy order tomorrow morning for a certain stock at such and such a limit. I told him my clients can't move such high numbers.
That couldn't have been all you said for him to hand over this index.
No, that was it. What you're looking at now is what he gave me, telling me if I just made him look good this time around, it'd be worth my while.
Still, it seems absurd to have so many members. Do they have a recruiter?
From what I've heard, they have someone who acts as liaison, but I don't know the details. Apparently, they increase their numbers by splitting cells and only communicate laterally. There's no chain of command.
So, member one might know member two, but not member three. By the way, did you believe him? When he showed you the index, I mean?
Truth is, I was a bit tempted. If this works as well as he says, you'd be free to do anything, from divesting unwanted shares to insider trading to manipulating deals, and the loss you'd incur is zero. It's like people with a guilty conscience all coming together and living like kings.
Then why not join them? Okabe's weak laugh spilled from the receiver.
10 years ago, I probably would have. Anyway, I thought that number 24's company, GSC Limited, might be the one owned by your acquaintance, the one you asked about before.
It's hard to tell without knowing the name of who's on the list. Negoro replied vaguely, knowing full well that Okabe would have looked up GSC Limited and confirmed that the representative of the company's founders was a former Toho News reporter before making this call. Negoro surmised that Okabe's intention was to draw him in so that he himself could find out a little more about this network.
"I'll dig around a bit," Negoro said. "And if I hit the jackpot, you'll tell me the name of this number 10 who tried to reel you in."
After the call, Negoro's eyes continued to drift over the sheet of paper, and before he knew it, he found himself back in the fog of the Ogura Chunichi scandal. When, for example, the founding clan of the Chunichi Mutual Savings had transferred their stock holdings to a third party, it was a non-bank called Sun Finance that loaned out $50 billion as a purchasing fund for said third party. An enormous amount of money had poured into the non-bank from financial institutions, banks as well as loads of shell companies from the Okada Association and the GSC Group, and part of that money was used to fund the third party's acquisition of the outstanding equity. It wasn't so far-fetched that the names of individuals with ties to Sun Finance, as well as those connected to the various shell companies, could be on this index. If Takeshi Kikuchi, the man who had planted old Toda to leak the Ogura Chunichi scandal to the newspapers, was number 24 on the list, odds were high that they were involved in this. Negoro was not surprised by the attempted resurgence of formerly subterranean roots, but the name Takeshi Kikuchi, flitting about in the periphery, nagged at his mind. Now the name had morphed into a symbol, member number 24, clamoring at him from this fax page, and the idea that the index itself had been prepared for him caused an irrepressible stirring in his gut. Negoro carefully set aside the thought that one day soon he would have to face Kikuchi in person and, quickly jotting down the names of the companies that numbers 19 through 30 worked for, he handed the memo to a student who worked in the archives and asked him to pull documents from Teikoku Data Bank. Then, as if there were some urgency, he went to make a call from a public phone. His call was to a mid-level freelance journalist who, back when the Ogura Chunichi scandal was in a frenzy, had sent reportage to Toho Weekly that thoroughly exposed the troubles with the land transport industry. He was one of the few journalists on the outside with whom Negoro could trade information in the name of cooperative investigation. Negoro knew he was unlikely to catch the journalist at this time, and sure enough, he heard the answering machine pick up, so he left a brief message. "This is Negoro from Toho. I've got a story over in Kabuto-cho. Give me a call when you can." Kyosuke Shiroyama. As he stared at the desk clock that read 8:58 p.m., Shiroyama closed the file of documents for tomorrow's colloquium of Japanese and European business leaders. 15 minutes ago, he had opened the file to distract himself, but the whole time his eyes had merely skimmed the surface of the pages. Shiroyama took out a digital handheld cellular phone and a Walkman from the drawer and set them on his desk. Kotani from the risk management company had connected to the Walkman a small specialized digital microphone that fit into his ear so that Shiroyama could record his conversation with the criminals. To prevent the police from being able to trace the call history, Kotani had lent Shiroyama one of his company's cell phones. The clock's hand pressed on, and another minute went by. The time specified by the criminals in the letter delivered that morning was between 9 o'clock and 9:05 p.m. The moment Shiroyama had clandestinely awaited the entire day was within reach, yet he could not bring himself to take the last step. Instead, he stared at the clock's minute hand as it slowly turned. There were all sorts of excuses for his pangs of conscience about going along with the criminal's instructions, but he could not reason away the visceral fear that was resurrected by the thought of hearing those voices again. As he took a deep breath, letting his eyes wander over to the nightscape outside his window, he glanced again at the small cell phone and the Walkman on his desk and tried to reel in a sense of resignation. It's too late now. The time was now 1 minute after 9. You have no choice but to call. It will be over in a few minutes. Shiroyama compelled himself to take the criminal's letter from that morning out of the drawer and spread it before him. Doing as Kotani had instructed, first he pressed the record button on the Walkman. Then he put in the earphone, picked up the cell phone, dialed the 8-digit number, and quickly pressed the speaker end of the phone over the microphone in his ear. The dial tone, a bit low and muffled, rang twice, then cut out.
"This is Shiroyama from Hinode," he heard his own raspy voice. "There are two items."
The voice did not belong to any of the men Shiroyama had heard during his confinement. It was much heavier, deeper, and rougher. Yet his manner of speaking, as if he were reading from a prepared script, was the same, as was the cruel, deadened tone, lacking any sense of excitement or emotion.
"First, have you kept the 600 million safe? Soon, we'll demand a second batch. This time, it will be for 700 million. Take out another 700 million from the bank and keep it separate from the 600 million that's stored away. That means a total of 1.3 billion in your safe for the time being. For the second delivery, take the 600 million that you've stored from the first transfer, plus 100 million from the additional 700 million for this time, for a total of 700 million. Any questions so far?"
"I don't understand."
"The police have already taken down the serial numbers of the first 600 million that's stored. If the second transaction is for 700 million, they'll take down the numbers of the additional 100 million. The 700 million to be used for the second delivery will all have their serial numbers tracked, but not the 600 million left in the vault. We want the bills whose numbers are not tracked. Now do you understand?"
As he listened to the criminal patiently explain the ploy, Shiroyama felt a dull torpor. Had he given the police this phone number, at this very moment, the man on the other end would no doubt have been apprehended somewhere. The anxiety he had borne for over a month now would have dissipated at once. What were the various circumstances that prevented him from doing so? Were any of them so hard to extract himself from?
"I understand," Shiroyama replied. "That's not all. Put white wrappers around the 700 million for the second delivery. As for the 600 million still left in the safe, put on light blue wrappers to tell them apart. Then, once we have finished the charade of the second delivery, do not return either the 700 million with the white wrappers or the 600 million with the light blue wrappers to the bank. Instead, store them again at your office with the wrappers intact. Got it?"
"I got it."
"And here's the second item. Listen carefully. From now on, this method of communication should be considered Hinode Beer's lifeline. Going forward, whenever we wish to make contact, we will give you a sign near your home in Sanno Nichome. Every morning, your car passes the Lutheran preschool that's on the bus route, correct? As you pull on to the bus route, if you recall, there is a brown street lamp on the corner to your left, to the right of the Sanno Nichome bus stop. In the morning, if there is white vinyl tape wrapped around the pole of the street lamp, you are to call this number that evening between 9 and 9:05. This line will not be available at any other time. We will wrap the tape so it can be easily spotted from the inside of the car. Any questions?"
White tape wrapped around the pole of a street lamp to the right of the bus stop. Despite being told that it would be easy to see, in the moment, Shiroyama could not imagine what kind of tape or exactly where the pole it would be wrapped around was.
"Please, isn't there a simpler way?" "No negotiations. Make sure to look carefully at the sidewalk on your left as your car pulls onto the bus route. That's all for tonight."
The call ended abruptly, and all at once, the sound of static was replaced by a steady busy signal. Shiroyama wondered if perhaps the number he had called was a public payphone, but that spark of an idea vanished instantly, replaced instead by a strange mixture of excitement and defeat at having moved one step closer to the culprits. As the thought recurred to him that the case might have been resolved by now if he had only informed the police, suddenly he began to question his own conduct and that of the company, only exacerbating his sense of defeat. All this time, Shiroyama had racked his brain, but no matter how he tried, the faces of the crime group eluded him. Aside from dangling the photo of his niece, the criminals had not made any concrete threats, and the same could be said about the intimidation that the 3.5 million kiloliters of beer were being held hostage. The germ of it was that by letting intangible anxieties get the better of him, he had managed to drive himself into a corner. And yet, even if the man who answered the phone tonight were arrested, without a guarantee that the rest of the criminals would all be rounded up, no company would be able to ignore the threat to comply, if you don't want the hostage to die. Moreover, while the criminals were contacting Hinode in good faith like this, there was room to observe their moves and determine how to react. He still had options. These reassurances finally enabled Shiroyama to come to terms with his current feelings. He grabbed his briefcase and switched off the lamp. When Shiroyama opened the door, Goda was standing by his chair in the anteroom. Right, this guy's still here, Shiroyama thought to himself, as if suddenly realizing he had left something behind. Thank you for waiting, Shiroyama said to him.
Yes, sir,
Goda replied, then took the key from Miss Nozaki's desk and swiftly opened the door for Shiroyama. Yuichiro Goda. Returning home to Yashio Park Town residential complex at about 10:30, Goda took the evening paper from the newspaper holder on the first floor and, seeing the bolded headline, Lady Joker's Cash Grab Fails, he proceeded to read every word of the article detailing the progress of the attempted money exchange. First, he reread three times the contents of the letter that was discovered at the Kyoto factory on the morning of the 8th, confirming that there was nothing to suggest what the criminals would do if their demands were not met. The substance of their threat must have been conveyed directly to the victim during the kidnapping or to Hinode via another channel. Though, on the one hand, the trick of moving around the cash transport vehicle from one place to the next was predictable, what drew Goda's attention was the detail with which the crime group had specified the exact times of arrival. Not later than 25 after, or get there by 11:30 p.m. For each instruction as to where the transport vehicle should go next. Judging the distance to each destination and the consideration that there would not be enough time for a detailed exchange with the police, in addition to the selection of a final destination that was inevitably difficult for the police to stake out, to a detective's eye, these particulars of the crime made the shadow of one of their own all the more conspicuous. Not just any of their own, someone who would know that an unmarked motorcycle would be used to tail suspects on the city streets and, since he had chosen a one-way road like Route 449, that would make a motorcycle chase difficult, that meant a detective who had been part of a mobile unit or who had experience working violent crime out of investigation headquarters. Goda figured that by now, the mood at investigation headquarters would be as heightened as ever, but wasn't sure whether not being there himself was lucky or unlucky. Once he had folded the newspaper and put it in the basket of his bicycle, the matter was out of sight, out of mind. He went up to his place on the fifth floor, took off his suit, and put the bananas and milk he had bought at the convenience store in the refrigerator. There was no time to draw a bath, so he took a shower while running the washing machine, brought in the previous day's laundry that was now dry, ironed the items, and skipped polishing his shoes. It was past 11:30 p.m. when he sat down at his writing desk with a can of beer and his notebook. He entered the date, May 10th, Wednesday, 1995, at the top of the form, and began writing his daily report. 7:45. Arrive in front of residence. Nothing abnormal in neighborhood. 7:47. Driver Yamazaki arrives as per usual. Exchange greetings only. 7:50. S boards vehicle. Clothes, expression, no appreciable changes. Exchange greetings. 8:05 to 15. While making the rounds through Togoshi Shopping District, S asked, "Why didn't the criminals show up last night?" I responded, "I don't know." No further conversation. S's expression inscrutable. 8:27.
Arrive at front entrance of Hinode's main office. S exchanges greetings with several employees in the lobby. Goes directly to 30th floor. 8:30. Arrive at President's Executive Suite. Secretary enters office to go over the day's schedule. 8:33. Secretary leaves office. I receive copy of schedule. 8:34. Managing Director Horikawa arrives at Executive Suite. Leaves 2 minutes later. Subject of conversation unknown. He seems hurried throughout. 8:40. Managing Director Tazawa arrives at Executive Suite. Leaves 2 minutes later. Subject of conversation unknown. No facial expression. 8:46. Assistant Manager of General Affairs Terai arrives at Executive Suite. Leaves 1 minute later. No facial expression. Note that S requested visits by both Tazawa and Terai via intercom to secretary. 8:50. Light on office phone signaling use of external line goes on. Other party unknown. Light goes off 5 minutes later. 9 o'clock to 20. No internal or external phone calls. Secretary remains at desk. 9:22. S goes out. Exits building through front entrance and boards vehicle. 9:56. Arrive at Japan Business Federation. En route to policy subcommittee meeting on 7th floor, S shares elevator with president of Nihon Shokuhin. After exchanging greetings, they chat about golf. A day in the life of a corporate executive was more complicated than Goda had anticipated. The past 3 days, once Shiroyama arrived in the morning, the only time he spent in his own office was a half hour in the morning and another half hour before going home. Even during those interstitial moments, there was an ongoing procession of executives coming and going and phone calls, all while he kept working at his desk, and when that was insufficient, he looked over papers in the car. From what Goda could glean just from his schedule, in addition to talks with clients, meetings with the executives of subsidiary and affiliated companies, and tours of their own factories and research facilities, Shiroyama had other external duties such as serving on financial and government advisory committees and attending pan-industry networking seminars. On top of this were interviews with newspapers and industry journals, visitors from inside and outside the company, extended business luncheons, and finally an hour or so in the evening for entertaining. All in all, it was a war of attrition. Goda had heard that Shiroyama was relatively detached when it came to taking part in political and business circles and socializing with bureaucrats. But according to SIT's briefing, ever since his abduction, he was under pressure to bolster the image that the company's business was robust and stable, which meant that his outings were even more numerous than before. Goda recorded the afternoon schedule line by line in his daily report. There was not even 10 minutes of leisure time. Various places visited, people Shiroyama had encountered, words exchanged, their outward expressions. 11:30. Meeting ends. S is last to leave the room. The president of Kawaii Heavy Machinery stopped S and asked, "Shiroyama-san, does your team find it difficult to take on a more aggressive approach after all?" To which S replied along the lines of, "We do, since it's still hard to say we've made an adequate prediction of the social and economic structural change that deregulation will bring about." The conversation did not go any further. 11:35, S boards a vehicle. Looks over documents en route. "These appear to be distributors' wholesale performance results." Says nothing. 11:56, arrive at Hinode Club in Kyoicho. Business luncheon with secretariats of the Distributors Association. The breakdown of the secretariats: Ida and Company, Inc. Tomioka, Inc. Otani Trading Company, Inc. Nihon Liquor, Inc. And Tokutomi Corporation, Inc. S greets the five representatives in the entrance hall. Exchanges greetings, talk of the weather. Two reporters from a weekly magazine and a photographer from a tabloid were staked out in front of the club and they were asked to leave. It was much too soon for Goda to be able to decipher which of the various facades Shiroyama displayed out in the world was closest to who he really was.
Perhaps he was not so keen on participating in external activities. In public, Shiroyama always seemed one step removed from everyone else, and his persona, which had very few distinguishing characteristics to begin with, made it hard to speculate about him. So far, the only things Goda could discern from his demeanor and manner of greeting others were a remarkable cautiousness that never allowed him to turn his back on anyone and the steely remove from which he surveyed the group. The luncheon at Hinode Club ended at 1:30, and after that, there was the inspection of the restaurant under construction at Higashi Azabu, which was a pilot program of their food service industry division. Then, a meeting with the Shinagawa District Chamber of Commerce and Industry at the Takanawa Prince Hotel, followed by an interview with The Economist at the same hotel. And finally, they went straight to a fancy restaurant in Tsukiji to entertain the governor of Gunma Prefecture and the mayor of Takasaki, a city located in that prefecture. Vice President Shirai and Managing Director Otani of the Pharmaceutical Business Division attended the dinner. Shirai, who seemed to be the presumed next president, gave off an air of refinement that was laced with cunning and was the only executive bold enough to speak directly to Goda. That very evening, he had shot a glance at Goda before entering the restaurant and then whispered,
"You're watching us like a detective, sir."
Meanwhile, tonight was the first time Goda had encountered Otani. The gathering ended at 7:50 p.m., and it was after the three members from Hinode had sent their two guests off in a hired car in the short time while they waited in the alleyway for the company car to retrieve them that Goda noticed Otani standing behind the president and the vice president, looking off in a completely different direction the whole time. Perhaps Hinode's board was not such a monolith after all. Afterward, Shiroyama returned to the office at 8:35 p.m., and since Miss Nozaki was already gone, Goda unlocked the door to the executive suite. Shiroyama headed into his office while Goda began to put his notes for the day in order, waiting in the secretary's anteroom for Shiroyama to finish his work. The anteroom where Goda passed the mornings and evenings gave a humble public servant like him a taste of the affluence of a private corporation. Within it, there was the desk used by Miss Nozaki, a copy and fax machine, a shredder, two armchairs for guests, and another chair that had been set out for Goda. The unadorned solid mahogany wall was actually a door that led to another fireproof door, behind which was functional shelving for storing research materials and documents. The room was simple, without a single ornament, but the solid wood desk was well polished. The chair, which was apparently of Swedish design, was inexplicably comfortable, and the desktop computer was not at all incongruous with the stately brass desk lamp, which was a piece of the highest quality from the Chapman Company. As he wrote out his notes, Goda admired the beauty of the lamp that illuminated the desk, and though she was absent, Miss Nozaki flickered in his mind. On his first day, Goda had intuitively noticed the way Miss Nozaki looked at Shiroyama, so yesterday he had paid attention to how Shiroyama reacted, and today Goda had concluded that the secretary had an unrequited crush. He wondered whether this should be included among the observations in his daily report, and ultimately decided to omit it. While Shiroyama was conducting his final business of the day, Goda kept at his own work in the anteroom, covering about 5 pages in his notebook with tiny letters. He was now copying several lines from the last page of those notes into his daily report. 20:35. Return to company building. Exchange greetings with only the guards. No sign of anyone else. 20:37. S goes into office. No internal or external calls. 21:02. Hear S speaking. Did he make a call from his office? Other party, subject of conversation, unknown. Must check for existence of cellular phone belonging to either Shiroyama or the company. At the time in question, 9:02 p.m., from his spot in the anteroom, Goda suddenly heard Shiroyama's voice on the other side of the door to his office saying, "This is Shiroyama from Hinode." During the daytime, the sounds of the fax machine's motor or the low hum of the UPS that was connected to the computer made it nearly impossible to hear voices in the president's office. But it was different at night when the machines had stopped running. Goda instinctively looked at the business phone on the secretary's desk, but neither of the lights for internal or external lines were on. Goda's immediate thought was that Shiroyama must be using a cellular phone, but since there would be no reason to bother using one when there was a phone on his desk, Goda rose from his chair and pressed his ear against the office door. About a minute after the first utterance, he heard Shiroyama say, "I don't understand." Another minute went by, and then, "I understand." Another minute later, and he heard, "I got it." Another minute and a half went by before the last words Goda could make out, "Isn't simpler way?" Shiroyama's voice sounded lower and more muffled than usual. Shiroyama was probably the one who had made the call, and since his intonation was not that of a typical business exchange, and he made the effort to use a cellular phone, there was cause for alarm no matter the circumstances. It was still possible that the murmuring was Shiroyama reading aloud some kind of introductory remarks, so Goda limited himself to vaguely noting in his daily report, "Must check for existence of cellular phone." Then he filled in the last three lines. 21:25. S finishes work. Shows signs of fatigue. Goes directly to underground parking lot and boards vehicle. 21:45. Return to Sanwo. Nothing abnormal in neighborhood. Recap. S, calm and relaxed throughout the day, showing no unusual changes in his expression or mannerisms. By the time Goda took the finished daily report and faxed it off to MPD's first SIT, it was 1 a.m. Goda poured himself 150 grams of whiskey, stared at the violin he hadn't touched for 2 days, left the BBC on at a low volume, and sprawled out on the bed. After 3 whole days with hardly anyone to speak to and limited chances of even hearing conversations, he found himself yearning to listen to voices, even on the television. Fumiaki Negoro. After the morning edition had gone to press, Negoro shared a can of beer with the Metro reporters who were on duty, then left the office at 2 a.m. on May 11th, early for him. He had made plans to meet Sano, the journalist he had contacted 12 hours earlier, in the parking area of the nearby Fairmont Hotel. When he arrived, the man in question was standing next to a Geländewagen with a gleaming three-pointed star emblem on its grille. Negoro could not resist saying, "Finally got yourself a Mercedes-Benz, huh? Are you mocking me?" "No, it's a compliment. Out of curiosity, mind if I ask what you paid?" "I got it used, $6 million, in 60 installments, with a 2% interest rate. I couldn't resist." Negoro peered into the face of the 40-year-old man who had a perennially youthful look, a common feature of those in his industry, thinking that even at 2%, a family man like Sano could not possibly be making enough to take on a loan of $6 million. "How's your wife and daughter?" Negoro asked. "Women always have more energy than men, so should we head to Shinbashi?" Hitching a ride in the steel box that supposedly went for 10 million yen if new, Negoro was doubly surprised by how unexpectedly uncomfortable it was and how poorly it handled. Since Sano never drank even a drop of liquor, they went to an all-night coffee shop near Shinbashi Station. Seated in a far corner, away from the smattering of couples there, Negoro sipped a pre-dawn coffee and began with a safe question. "What are you up to these days?" "I'm on contract as a reporter with a sports paper. The rest is freelance," Sano replied. At the sports paper, he covered news about the economy, and since lately the financial collapse was close at hand, he said he had been writing a fair number of articles. "Do you have a story you're investigating right now?" "Nothing solid. That's why I'm here with you now, Negoro-san." For his part, Negoro wanted to ascertain the level of Sano's investigative chops, but since you never really knew how things would go until you were in the thick of it, he had no choice but to trust Sano's past performance.
Now that he thought about it, even the 6 million yen Mercedes-Benz paid off 100,000 or so every month could still be within the realm of possibility for a man who spent nothing on drinking. In any case, it wasn't enough cause to assume Sano's income and expenditures were suspicious. Sano seemed eager to get the conversation started, making the standard overture that he would protect any secrets. And after Negoro rejoined with the additional caveats that Toho News had nothing whatsoever to do with the issue at hand, and that it was a personal investigation undertaken on his own part, they came to an agreement for the time being. Negoro placed the sheet of A4 paper faxed by Okabe, the securities man, on the table. Sano looked at it for a moment, then asked, "Some kind of group?" "Ostensibly, this is a network for manipulating the market," Negoro answered. "But I don't know the reality of the situation," he added, and arranged on the table the materials from Teikoku Data Bank on each of the 12 companies listed in the index. Sano leafed through them and said with a little laugh,
"Are they listed under their former names or something?"
"So, what do you think?"
"The first concern is, who's behind all this?"
Sano said with a reliably keen instinct.
"Then, since I'm sure not all the members are managing their own capital, the second issue is how much of whose money they are moving around. Third issue is the actual method for making deals. The fourth is, well, whether a group like this actually exists, right?"
"That's exactly right."
"Is this really about market manipulation?"
"That's what I've heard, but there's no evidence."
"With your pick of securities companies to choose from, it would be possible to spread around all kinds of clever tricks. No matter what they want to do, there's safety in numbers."
"I have a hunch that their motivation is a little more aggressive. For instance, they might keep the asset steady for a specific period so that they can then make a large transaction."
"Or make transactions on credit and then float a big rumor before a certain date?"
"No, I feel like this group is a little smarter than that," Negoro replied carefully as he pictured the name of number 24, Takeshi Kikuchi, the financial muscle of GSC Group and the Okada Association, and the 18 channels of securities companies on the index. "See, this group has what it takes to be a triple threat: speculation professionals, capital, and dealmakers. If they wanted to clean up by speculating, the biggest deal they can make on a fixed amount is in futures. If it were me, and I've got 18 channels at my disposal, I'd start by getting my hands on physical shares. To keep the share price steady, I'd have my friends go short, little by little, while I'd gradually go long. Meanwhile, I'd also be buying up futures as well."
"If they're trying to move the index, they'd need at least multiple billions in capital."
"With that level of profit expected, there'd be plenty of guys ready to get in on it. The capital is there. We've been seeing all the favorable conditions for a while now. A bear market, light trading, huge unsettled buying balances. It'd be easy to create the conditions to liquidate."
"By creating, you mean selling futures little by little while also selling physical shares bit by bit? And by doing so, the market itself drops incrementally, but since futures tend to fall with greater volatility than physical shares, the conditions to liquidate those unsettled buying balances will be in place. Once buybacks for futures start to trickle in, now you're poised to sell. Do I have that right?"
Sano paused. Then, with a bitter laugh, he muttered,
"I follow your logic."
His face turned serious again as he said,
"If this organization has that kind of financial power, then this is pretty risky. Negoro-san, why don't you start by telling me how you acquired this index?"
Sano had him there. Now it was Negoro's turn to dodge with a laugh. "All I can say is that I got it from an acquaintance at a securities company."
"Then what is it about this group that piqued your interest, Negoro-san? It's not the kind of story that Toho's Metro Desk Reserve Chief would pry into. Is there a personal motive?"
"You could say that."
"Negoro-san, let's be frank with each other. What do you think will come of shaking things up with this group?"
"I'm not sure, but there's the upper house election in July."
"Ah, now I get it. So, Negoro-san,
If this works, do you see it as a consolation match for the old Ogura Chunichi scandal?
No, nothing like that. Negoro denied it flatly, but Sano chuckled to himself, his shoulders shaking slightly with satisfaction.
Back in the days of the media frenzy surrounding the Ogura Chunichi scandal, Sano had worked diligently to clear away obstacles by scrupulously investigating the land transportation industry and the small to mid-sized companies that were loanees of the former Chunichi Mutual Savings Bank. Negoro had predicted from the start that once he had revealed the story to Sano, there would be no way to evade his questions.
"I'll take these with me then," Sano said.
As Negoro watched Sano put the files in his bag, he began to ponder some questions of his own. Who had latched on to this dubious index of 30 people and wanted to uncover what it was for? The answer was himself. What justification was there in handing off a story that he had no way of running in the pages of a national newspaper to a freelance journalist? The answer was none. The only thing he had was his own deeply personal and impure motive. What it came down to was his own meaningless desire, lacking in purpose and not even qualifying as revenge, to expose the name of even a single one of the Cretans who attempted to mow him down 4 years ago. Did he recognize this? The answer was yes.
"If possible, I'd like you to consult me before investigating number 24. "Is there something about him?"
"He's a former newspaper reporter. I can't tell what kind of connections he has."
"Any others whose identity you're aware of?"
"No, only 24.
"I understand. In any case, if I sense danger, then I'll withdraw. I've got no plans to die on account of shady characters moving money around."
While Negoro agreed wholeheartedly with this logic, he knew it was in a journalist's nature to be unable to pull back from a story. For Negoro's part, he would need to pay close attention to the investigation's progress by keeping in regular contact with Sano from now on. Sano's Geländewagen lorded over the national highway at dawn as he sped off along the Daiichi Keihin. Before catching a taxi to return to the ryokan where he was staying, Negoro stepped into a telephone booth to check the messages on the answering machine at his apartment in Kamata, in Setagaya District. He hadn't been home in over a month.
"This is Yamada from the Residents Association. I'm just calling about your membership fee for April."
Beep. "This is the dry cleaners calling. We haven't received your payment for March, so please let us know."
Beep.
"Hello, this is Yayoi from Akasaka. You haven't visited in so long. I'm afraid I'll forget what you look like, Negoro-san. Please come see me again, won't you?"
He did not remember a Yayoi from anywhere.
Beep.
"This is Harusa Kubo. I'm on my way home from being out with a source drinking in Setagaya, but I just passed by your building in Kamata, so I stopped at your place, but you weren't there, so I... Wait, what did I want to tell you? Oh, right. I was so drunk that I rang the bell to the apartment next door to yours. So sorry. I made sure to apologize to your neighbor. Sorry."
Beep.
Negoro put down the receiver, aghast at how inebriated Kubo sounded. If Kubo had been out drinking in Setagaya, it was plausible that he'd have passed Kamata on his way home.
Yet the fact that he had taken the time to stop by Negoro's apartment could mean that Kubo had hit upon a drunken idea that he wanted to share. Negoro would have expected that right about now Kubo would be on cloud nine after his big Lady Joker exclusive 24 hours earlier, but his intoxicated state suggested that he was already feeling the pressure of a follow-up story. While the evening edition had boldly blared on about how the mystery deepens, there was still no way to know what the next move would be by the crime gang that was targeting Hinode Beer. Negoro tried to remember which bar this woman Yayoi was from. Akasaka, she said? As the image of an unidentifiable woman flitted behind his eyelids, the thought, maybe sometime, was quickly followed by the proviso, we'll see, and he exited the telephone booth without making a call, then hailed a cab.
Kyosuke Shiroyama. Friday, May 12th, began for Shiroyama with foreboding, the result of a brief from the control center at the main office that came in just after 6 in the morning. We've received LJ number 3. The police were referring to the letters that the Lady Joker crime gang had been tossing inside the gates of Hinode's factories as LJ number 1 and LJ number 2, and apparently this new LJ number 3 had been discovered inside the back gate of their Sendai factory. The amount of their demand had increased to 700 million, just as had been discussed over the phone on the evening of the 10th. The exchange was to take place tomorrow, Saturday the 13th. Frankly, Shiroyama had thought that the criminals would take a bit more time in between, so the second attempt coming 4 days after the first felt unexpected. Moreover, that morning Shiroyama had seen from the window of his company car that a 2 centimeters wide white tape had been wrapped around the pole of a street lamp to the right of the bus stop at Sangon Nichome. The tape was surprisingly conspicuous, so long as he was already keeping an eye out for it. However, as soon as he had confirmed the presence of the white tape, Shiroyama began to fret that he would need to do as the criminals had said and call them again at 9 that evening. He was still steeped in these feelings of shame when he arrived at the main office before 8, as usual, and the day's work began. The first item after Miss Nozaki confirmed his schedule was a copy of the letter that had been tossed inside the Sendai factory gate, sent up from the control room with word that they had already alerted the police. Next, Shiroyama placed a call to the managing director of finance, Horikawa, and said tersely, "I'm counting on you." As per the criminals' demands, white wrappers would be placed around the original 600 million, the serial numbers of which the police had already marked, while the additional 100 million with white wrappers was to be delivered from the bank in a Duralumin case. The new 600 million would be withdrawn from their account in smaller amounts and transported to the main office in shopping bags. Horikawa was one of the executives who knew about the 2 secret letters that warned, "If you don't want the hostage to die, don't let the police know about this letter," as well as the taped phone call from the night of the 10th with the criminal's instructions, and yet his awkward tone failed to hide his confusion as he replied,
"Yes, at the bank, everything's... yes."
Hearing Horikawa's voice so early in the morning and loaded as it was with an apparent need to say something more, Shiroyama could barely restrain himself from making an emotional outburst. "Have you even seen what's in the papers? This is no time for second-guessing." If one were to reflect upon the outcome of the first attempt, the police's information management could only be described as sloppy, though they had boasted of forcing the criminals to make a move in order to apprehend them. In reality, not only did the police struggle to deploy the motorcycle tail, the cash transport vehicle then failed to arrive by the time specified by the criminals. Given these circumstances, and since they didn't want the hostage to die, the obvious choice was, to the extent possible, to adhere to the criminal's explicit instructions. Amid his irritation, when Shiroyama acknowledged that it would have been strange not to be confused by a situation in which they were forced to illicitly withdraw 600 and then 700 million of the money their employees worked so hard to earn, he ended up pitying himself for these riled-up emotions, and with a renewed sense of his own inconsistency, Shiroyama opened the reports submitted first thing in the morning by each business division. As of May 1st, the beer division had begun temporarily holding back 30% of shipments, so their ledger had become cumbersome to process. 30% was equivalent to the share intended for regular households outside of commercial use. Since the company paid the National Tax Agency 44.1%, based on sales of what they shipped, this was an effort to contain their losses in the event that they were forced to suspend all shipments. It was a decision that Kurata had pushed through over the opposition of the boards of directors and auditors, but in reality, since neither production nor shipments had been halted, there was a limit to what could be processed in accounting. 3 minutes later, Kurata himself bustled into the president's office.
"Take a look at this," he said, as he placed an analysis of securities company's deal tactics on Shiroyama's desk.
Only the day before yesterday, Shiroyama had instructed Horikawa to check with the person in charge of securities about the market conditions, and the response had been that there was nothing in particular to be concerned about. Kurata, however, had not agreed with that assessment. He was adamant that, even compared to past deal records, it was clearly abnormal to see trades being spread out over a dozen brokerages for 36 consecutive business days. Glancing at the document placed on his desk, Shiroyama saw that the deal tactics did not refer to Hinode stocks, but rather to those of Mainichi Beer.
"We've learned that Mainichi Beer shares have also seen similar transaction activity to ours over the last month," Kurata said.
"So, what does this mean?"
"A number of speculators might be focusing on physical shares of beer companies. Presumably, they'll also start selling futures as well. There's no way to look it up, but if speculators were trying to make money with index futures and options, then it's possible that when it gets closer to the contract delivery month, we could see transactions of physical shares on a scale of 100 times more than this. If that happens, our share price would be in for a bumpy ride."
"Do you think this has anything to do with Lady Joker?"
"If the criminals were to inflict immediate damage to the beer industry, the guys making short futures trades at the brokerages right now wouldn't be able to stop laughing. If I were the criminals, I'd do it."
"You mean attack our products?"
"I mean that in case the criminals have a mind to cash in by moving stocks around, we don't know what could happen in the long term. It's fine to keep up the drama of the money exchanges, but please tell the criminals to hurry up with the main event."
Kurata turned on his heel with the same agitation as when he had come in, but just as he took a step, he looked back at Shiroyama for 2 seconds and whirled around again.
"I'd like to send Sugihara abroad for a while,"
Kurata suggested after a moment's pause. Shiroyama had expected to hear these words from Kurata one of these days. Now that the time had come, it felt neither too soon nor too late.
"This is very difficult for me to say, but right now, Sugihara lacks morale. During this crucial time, it's hard to keep the beer division together based on popularity alone." "I'll leave that to your discretion. Please gauge how Sugihara is feeling and do what you think is best."
"I'll take it up with Shirai-san too. In any case, it's not something we need to decide today or tomorrow." After Kurata left, Shiroyama had returned to scanning the remainder of the reports, mindful of the dwindling time left when the image of Takeo Sugihara flickered on the page before him. When Shiroyama reflected upon it, all his memories of Sugihara's face from the last few years were vague and blurry around the edges. Sugihara may have been an industrious worker who stood out for his analytical skills, who was adept at capturing people's hearts and known for his sense of compassion, but his face made no impression. Kurata had euphemistically referred to his morale and such, but Shiroyama was well aware that for someone on the front lines of the beer division, Sugihara was undeniably lacking in strategy and leadership, never mind morale. Lately, Sugihara had spent many days out of the office, making the rounds of their distributors in order to strengthen relationships, so their paths had rarely crossed. But Shiroyama would need to make time to speak with the man himself.
"It's time for your departure," Miss Nozaki's voice announced through the intercom. The clock showed that it was 9:01. As he gathered the files with the reports he hadn't finished reading and put them in his briefcase, he glimpsed a weekly tabloid underneath. He opened to the page with a marker and was surprised to see a photo of his own profile.
"Burdened with Hinode's troubles and looking exhausted," read the caption. Shiroyama had no memory of where the photo had been taken, but the caption, "looking exhausted," was perfect for this upper-middle-aged man walking with stooped shoulders and downcast eyes, so that even he had to admit it was a win for the paparazzo who hadn't let the photo op go by. Golda, 3 steps behind Shiroyama in the photo, in contrast, stood up straight. But since he was turned in a different direction, his face was not visible.
"Aha, the guy is always this close behind me, huh?" This minor discovery was a distraction, after which Shiroyama stood up, briefcase in hand.
That morning, 3 hours were taken up touring the technical training center adjacent to the Kanagawa factory, making the rounds of their company factories and research labs. Listening to what the young employees had to say was Shiroyama's favorite way to spend time at work. His attention tended to be distracted by his extensive yet trivial daily duties, and this practice helped to pull his vision back to where it ought to be. Seeing these people working on site, he could gauge whether human resources were being maximized along whichever particular line of work, and this also gave him the chance to evaluate himself as a manager. Above all, whenever he couldn't think clearly or he felt stuck, on-site interaction was the most effective way to shift his mood. Shiroyama could only spend about an hour at the training center because of the time it took to travel there and back. Yet the 60 engineers in training who had started working at the small-scale experimental plant in April had just completed the fermentation process for the first beer they had prepared themselves, and Shiroyama joined them as they tasted the new beer that had been fermented in 4 batches, each with a different type of yeast. In addition, the visit presented an opportunity for Shiroyama to witness the flash of a smile from Goda. He remained 3 steps behind Shiroyama the whole time, but during a half-hour tour of the factory after the tasting and discussion at the training center, Shiroyama offered Goda a fresh sample of Hinode Meister that was about to be bottled, saying, "This is what beer really tastes like." Immediately after taking a sip of the smooth beer, Goda's face broke into a natural smile and his white teeth flashed as he gasped with wonder.
"Wow!"
Then he drained the rest of the glass and murmured,
"This really is delicious."
Shiroyama could tell that Goda was a man who was not only fond of alcohol, but also knew how to savor it. And even more impressive was that Goda did not primly refuse because he was on duty. Perhaps he was thirsty, or his curiosity got the better of him, or else he decided to prioritize their relationship. The intention was unclear. Whatever his motives, Goda had obliged Shiroyama's offer of a drink in a way that was refreshing, and so was the manner in which he partook. Shiroyama had made another unexpected discovery. After returning to Tokyo past noon, there was a succession of events for the colloquium of Japanese and European business leaders that had gotten underway yesterday. First, a luncheon, followed by the day 2 subcommittee meetings to discuss the climate for EU investment after the currency unification, and then a plenary session to deliver a summary report. Afterward, Shiroyama invited the chairman of Kreuzer, a major beer maker in Germany, with whom they had signed a license agreement, to the exclusive restaurant Kicho for dinner. Vice Presidents Shirai and Kurata were both in attendance, as well as Terata, the president of Toei Bank, and for nearly 2 hours, they delved into an intense discussion about the uncertain future of Hinode Kreuzer's strategy in Asia. At the present time, considering the growth rates of its population and economy, the scale of the Asian market might have undoubtedly seemed gigantic, but it was impossible to establish a 10-year prediction. As an investment, China posed large concerns due to its delays in legislation and questions about future energy sources. Moreover, it was inevitable that China's economic development would occur alongside the country's hegemonic expansion. As the Chinese economic bloc began to swallow Southeast Asian countries, where improvements in the social infrastructure and political systems would not be able to keep up, there was increased risk that the military instability of the entire East Asia region would worsen. Added to this was the political unrest in India and Pakistan. In the near future, there was little doubt that on a global scale, corporations would become increasingly borderless. But apart from that, an economic zone could develop to accommodate the chaos unique to Asia. Hinode Kreuzer had established a joint venture in Shanghai 10 years ago, but unless they sought out more in-depth know-how for localization, further progress on their conventional attempt to advance into the market would be difficult. These were the topics of conversation. Since the business dinner ran a little longer than planned, Shiroyama hurried to return to his office at 8:30.
First, he arranged on his desk the cell phone and the Walkman with the microphone attached. Then he glanced over the memos that Miss Nozaki had laid out for him, as well as the reports from each business division. There were no matters that required his immediate attention, but among the memos was a message from Zenzo Tamaru that he would call on Monday the 15th. By the time he put the memos away in his desk drawer and paused for a breath, it was already 9:05. Shiroyama slowly drank a glass of water as he stared at the clock's minute hand. Once again, he had been on the move all day without a moment of respite since the morning, and though he had managed to get through all the necessary business without delay, as he gazed at the clock ticking away the rest of the day, he felt as if each task he had thus accomplished was floating away somewhere, disappearing from his grasp. Now that he thought about it, these last 36 years had been a repetition of this same process, but perhaps that was essentially what it meant to work at a corporation. Even with the added weight of responsibility, it made no difference. He took care of a job and watched it disappear. He tried to tell himself that, much in the same way, the act of making this telephone call to the crime gang would depart from his hands as soon as it was done and bring the day to a close. At 9:02 p.m., Shiroyama slid the small microphone into his ear as before, switched on the Walkman's recording function, and dialed the criminal's number, whose local prefix he knew was within Ota District. He pressed the cell phone to the microphone in his ear. The phone rang twice before it connected, and he said, "This is Shiroyama."
"Wanted to confirm that you saw the tape."
The same voice as before.
"We're counting on you tomorrow."
Immediately, Shiroyama heard a busy signal. His palms had broken out into a cold sweat without him realizing it, so that his fingers slipped when he switched off the recording. Perhaps more than whether he had seen the tape, what the criminals were interested in knowing was Hinode's intention. For now, Shiroyama told himself, he had managed to finish the day. When he turned off the light and left the room 3 minutes later, Shiroyama found Goda standing by the secretary's desk as usual, but Shiroyama suddenly felt as though he was the one being watched. It was only for a brief second that their eyes met, but Goda's seemed different from before, like the black hole of a camera lens. In that instant, swept up with an unknown momentum, Shiroyama had the sense that Goda had seen through him. It struck him that Goda may have heard the call just now, but the only thing he had uttered was his name. It was impossible to have wiretapped the digital cell phone using some kind of mechanical device. Even if his conversation had been overheard, there was not much to it, so perhaps he was reading too much into Goda's expression. As such thoughts rushed through his head, Shiroyama unconsciously called out, "Goda-san." The hand that was reaching for the door stopped in midair, and Goda turned around. There was no longer any particular gleam in his eyes.
"Has Miss Nozaki informed you about tomorrow's golf game?" Shiroyama asked.
"Yes, sir. I'll pick you up at 7.
"Do you play golf?"
"No, sir."
"Make sure to bring a hat with you tomorrow. The sun can be very strong on the golf course."
"I'll do that,"
Goda replied, politely bowing his head before opening the door for Shiroyama. As he observed Goda's movements, Shiroyama had another question for himself. Was this man before him really no more than a bodyguard? Fumiaki Negoro. Before noon on Saturday, May 13th, just as the articles for the evening paper's third edition had begun to file into the reserve section, the slot editor at the adjacent copy desk gave out a startled cry, "What the?" and then leaned out from behind his computer.
"It's from the Kicha Club. They say Hinode is carrying out their second money exchange right now. The cash transport vehicle drove out of the Shinjuku Isetan parking lot at 11:15 a.m. and is headed toward Ikebukuro. Vehicle is a red Honda Accord wagon, carrying 700 million. That's all we know for now. I need everyone from the Hinode team."
The first thing that came to mind for Negoro was an image of the old multi-story parking garage on the west side of Isetan Department Store. The structure was located in the heart of the bustling shopping district on the east side of Shinjuku Station, and, on a Saturday afternoon, the area, which faced the two major thoroughfares of Shinjuku-dori and Meiji-dori, would be jam-packed with people and cars. And in the midst of it, a red Accord wagon. 700 million. A mere 4 days after the first attempt on the 9th.
"It's the second exchange! The second!"
the slot editor Tabe blurted out as he leapt off the sofa by the window, heading straight toward Negoro.
"Negoro-kun, there'll be an advance article coming in from the Kisha Club, so revise it. Yamazaki, you secure the interviews. Layout, we'll have to swap out page one. Hey, Yamamoto, go get someone from the photo department."
"It's the club," said another voice from the sub-desk. "They want us to send someone to help stake out the area around the Ikebukuro Police Department."
"I'm on it,"
a young reporter from the reserve section volunteered, while other voices shouted,
"We need a map!"
And, "What's the traffic report on the radio saying?"
Negoro inhaled deeply and steadied his breathing, then stared at the article in his hands that was about to be filed. If the exchange was happening right now, there wouldn't be many stories coming in before deadline. Would there be an article worth printing at the top of the metro page? If not, was there a related article that could be used? As he ran through these snap decisions, Negoro opened the file of articles that hadn't been used for the first attempted money exchange and leafed through them.
"Has the draft from the club arrived? Forget about the third edition. Let's go big on the fourth."
This from Metro Chief Maeda, who had quickly returned to his own desk. Nearby, Tabe was yelling into the direct line to the Kisha Club.
"Just find out the location. We'll send a guy in a car," he shouted.
Then, setting the receiver down, he mumbled,
"Doesn't seem like they're gonna get the story."
Negoro looked at the clock. 3 minutes past noon. The advance article that was supposed to come in from the club still hadn't arrived. The NHK news at noon was already on the TV, but there were no alerts about Hinode. 700 million in a red Accord wagon. Already 48 minutes since the vehicle left Shinjuku at 11:15 a.m. If headed for Ikebukuro, it was long past the time it should have arrived. Judging by the fact that the MPD Kisha Club's reporters covering first investigation hadn't gotten wind that this exchange was happening until the last minute, Negoro speculated that, for whatever reason, they were having a hard time covering the action. Tabe, his ear still glued to the direct line, repeated,
"Not yet? Nothing's come in yet?"
While Negoro, who with no advance article filed, held fast to his stack of backup articles, until finally a voice from the layout desk pressed for a decision.
"Can we go ahead with the third edition as is?" "Let's swap from the fourth edition," replied Maeda.
"Then Negoro-san, give us back those articles about the homicide and the scam," cried another voice from the sub-desk.
As the NHK news was ending, Maeda sidled up behind Negoro and whispered,
"Go get the other bulls."
Negoro quickly scanned the reserve section to see who he could send to the nearest subway station at Hanzomon.
"Ono, come here,"
he said, gesturing to the young man. Back when he was a cub reporter, Negoro had often gone on the same errand, rounding up the early editions of rival newspapers that had just been delivered to the train station kiosks to see if, as they put together their own final edition, they had been scooped.
Haruhisa Kubo.
It was 11:50 a.m. when the leak about the second money exchange came in from a source at the first mobile investigation unit. They had no idea what the police's movements had been since then. Haruhisa Kubo's wristwatch ticked past 12:30 p.m. To make matters worse, his hired car was stuck in a major traffic jam that was going nowhere. A large fire seemed to have broken out somewhere in Ikebukuro, where he was headed. And above the din of sirens from the fire trucks and patrol cars, he could hear the roar of helicopters overhead.
"Must be traffic control. Wonder where the fire is," Kubo murmured while the driver tuned his car radio to the frequency of the traffic report.
Pressed for time, Kubo looked down at his watch again. It was already 12:33 p.m. Still no follow-up from his source. Yet it was only natural given the circumstances. Shinjuku, the starting point of this money exchange, was under the jurisdiction of the second mobile investigation unit. His source in the first mobile investigation unit had been deployed to a peripheral area, and this time, Chief Inspector Kanzaki's Special Investigation Headquarters had gone to extremes to keep all details under wraps from the mobile investigation units. The only information that Kubo's source could give him at the time of his deployment was a red Accord wagon, license plate 54N1813X. Driver wearing a blue sleeveless undershirt. 3 shopping bags from Isetan Department Store in the trunk, stuffed with 700 million yen in old banknotes. Suspects have identified themselves as Lady Joker. Not only that, apparently his source hadn't been told where to go until 10 a.m., immediately before his deployment. This time, it seemed the tail vehicles and those deployed near the action were using a different frequency than usual on the investigation radio. Which meant that, after the Accord wagon left Isetan parking lot at 11:15 a.m. and headed north along Meijidori Avenue, the tail vehicle's wireless had cut out near the Chitose Bridge on Meijidori Avenue. It was shortly after that when Kubo's source had called to give him the tip. Kubo got the time the wireless went dead, 11:43 a.m., from his source, and surmised that if that was the completion point for the deployment to the next destination of investigators who had been assigned the special radio frequency, then the second destination was not far north of Meijidori Avenue. It was most likely the area around Ikebukuro Station, a stone's throw from Chitose Bridge. It was that hunch that had him speeding toward Ikebukuro in a hired car where he now sat stuck in traffic. As a precaution, Kubo already had the draft of an 80-line advance article on standby, and even if he didn't make it any further, he could still send word, but in that case, he'd have to put in a call to Kanzaki of First Investigation and determine the timing of the scoop. Should he wait until 1 p.m. or hold off until just before the deadline for the fourth edition? The time was now 12:36 p.m. His hired car remained immobile in front of Zoshigaya Elementary School. The string of traffic along Meijidori Avenue hadn't budged an inch, and as the sirens headed for Ikebukuro droned on, the traffic report finally came through over the radio. There are several road closures due to a fire that broke out in Sunshine City at around 12:30 p.m. today. In Ikebukuro, roads between the Mutsumata Rikkyo Overpass intersection and the Sunshine intersection, as well as roads around Sunshine City, are all closed. The Higashi Ikebukuro junction of the Shuto Expressway Ikebukuro Route No. 5 is also sealed off. As a result of these road closures, there is severe traffic along Meijidori Avenue near Ikebukuro Station. "Head to the site of the fire!" Kubo yelled at the driver, and no sooner had he opened to a blank page in his notebook and scribbled the date and time, he was already prepared to head to a new scene. The fire had broken out at Sunshine City, a building complex packed with restaurants, offices, a shopping mall, a hotel, various entertainment facilities, and a 60-story skyscraper. A catastrophe on a Saturday afternoon. The top article on the Metro page. The instant that the prospect of a fresh, exclusive story cut through his mind, Kubo already felt as if he had gone off the rails. 40 minutes left until the deadline for the fourth edition. With a little luck, he'd have 2 exclusives. 3 seconds later, Kubo's hired car had veered off Meijidori Avenue and was speeding through the back streets of Minami Ikebukuro. Within a minute, the skyscraper loomed into the small patch of sky visible from deep within the alley. The blare of the sirens and the loudspeakers from police PR trucks grew louder, and the whirr of helicopters came rumbling ever closer. A phone call came in from the Kisha Club, and when Kubo answered distractedly, Chief Sugana warned him in a heavy voice,
"The smoke in Sunshine City is apparently coming from the underground parking lot. Keep an eye out for any connection to Lady Joker."
Yuichiro Goda. Under the rays of the early summer sun, Shiroyama's half-day at Kogane Country Club passed quite leisurely. Goda, following behind in the caddy's golf cart, was obliged to spend the morning at the same pace. Of the players assembled for the day, Shiroyama and Chairman Suzuki were the only 2 from Hinode. The others were presidents representing Hinode's major stockholders, including 4 banks, a life insurance company, and a property and casualty insurance company. Tea time had been at 9 in the morning, with the men splitting up into two groups, and observing the play was like watching a snail work its way through a patch of sunlight. Goda wasn't sure whether this was because, aside from Shiroyama, the players were all in their mid-60s, or if it was due to the sense of latitude afforded to those belonging to the uppermost echelon of the business community. First, the players made a fuss about addressing the ball. Then, they spent more time hitting balls that had been driven into a grove of trees back onto the fairway, and once the ball finally landed on the green, they dawdled over the putting, and after they holed out, they ambled on to the next tee. Throughout it all, the cheerful conversation never lapsed, but Goda, observing the proceedings for the half-day, could not altogether dismiss the blatant pretense of these cross-shareholders. To Goda's eye, anyone who belonged to the private sector seemed like an alien donning a thick mask. Kyosuke Shiroyama was no exception. The game was finished by 4 in the afternoon, and in the end, all 8 players managed to score around 110, proof of their experience. From what Goda could tell, the bets that were settled privately at the conclusion of the game did not seem to exceed the 1,000 yen mark. On the return trip, Goda rode with Shiroyama and Suzuki as he had on the way there, and the car delivered Suzuki to his home in Seijo before heading to Sanno. Along the way, the only conversation that Goda overheard from the passenger seat was about golf. He hadn't taken his eyes off them throughout the whole day, so he was certain there had been no report from the office about the results of the second money exchange that was to have taken place that afternoon. But he couldn't figure out why there had not been a single phone call or why Shiroyama had not requested a report himself. It stood to reason that Hinode might have known from the start how it would play out, but that explanation didn't sit well with Goda either. When they arrived at Suzuki's home in Seijo, Goda leapt out of the passenger seat, opened the car door for Suzuki, carried his golf bag from the trunk to the entrance of his home, and bowed deeply to his wife, who had come to the door. 40 minutes later, he repeated the same actions at Shiroyama's home in Sanno. All day, Shiroyama had not disclosed a shred of emotion or any private asides to Goda, but there was something about Shiroyama's back which he kept turned toward Goda. Goda would venture to say that he detected a tension that hadn't been present before. Perhaps this was why Goda, having spent the day wondering if Shiroyama was wary of him, felt quite mentally exhausted. He was eager to get home and read the evening paper, so he skipped his daily shopping and rode his bike, which had been parked at the east exit of Omori Station, directly to Yashio Park Town. A sedan was parked on the east side of the road in front of his building, and Assistant Police Inspector Satoru Hirase, head of MPD's first special investigation team, peered out from the driver's seat window and signaled with his chin. Goda got off his bike. Hirase was the recipient of Goda's daily reports. Back when Goda was at MPD, he rarely came into contact with SIT detectives, who worked out of a separate building, but he had previously crossed paths with Hirase twice during a kidnapping case and twice again during an abduction and unlawful confinement case, and it was clear to both of them that they rubbed each other the wrong way. Though small in stature for a detective at 170 centimeters, Hirase was an athletic, no-nonsense man who worked out at a training gym and ran 5 kilometers every morning without fail. Still, with the bulk of his days consumed with cumbersome desk work and managing the interpersonal relationships within the police force, the reality was that anyone in his position would feel a psychological toll. And, true to form, whenever he was on a case, Hirase's paranoid obsessiveness would rear its ugly head. This time was no different. As soon as Goda climbed into the passenger seat of the sedan, Hirase commented, "The light's on in your apartment."
"I forgot to turn it off," Goda replied.
"No, someone's inside." There was no reply when I buzzed the intercom, but I heard the sound of the vacuum cleaner. "It's your ex-wife's brother, isn't it? It's bad enough for a cop to be connected to a prosecutor, but now you're spending time together off-duty? I don't believe it." Hirase, for his part, was rumored to have had to break off his own engagement when his superior forced him into marrying his divorced daughter. Goda didn't even bother telling Hirase he was one to talk. He merely scoffed at their equally sorry lives.
Aren't things busy for you too? Please get to the point.
I'm here on First Investigation Chief's orders. Why else would anyone show up?
Having made no effort to hide his moodiness, Hirase practically slammed the evening edition of Toho News onto Goda's knee. Goda glimpsed the banner headlines on the front page.
Lady Joker makes second cash demand and criminals are no-show.
But since he hadn't been alerted to any of the details about the money exchange, it didn't have much impact. Without giving Goda time to read the article, Hirase then handed over three sheets of paper. The first page was a copy of LJ number 3, a combination of handwritten kanji and katakana letters. Prepare 700 million in used bills. Pack them in three shopping bags from Isetan Department Store. Load them in a red station wagon. A single driver wearing the same attire as last time. Carry a cellular phone. On May 13th, 11 a.m., enter the Isetan parking lot in Shinjuku Sanchome and await further instructions. Contact will be made to CSHND. Lady Joker. Like last time, the perpetrators did not make any threats as to what would happen if orders were not followed. While the cash transport vehicle used in the last money exchange had been white, this time it was red. Perhaps they had chosen a distinctive color so that they would not lose sight of it on Shinjuku's bustling streets. The second page was the text of the email sent to CSHND, Hinode's customer service line. Park the car in front of the main office of Tokyo Credit Union at Ichome, Higashi Ikebukuro, and wait there for instructions. Lady Joker. Considering the road conditions around noon on a Saturday, it would take roughly 30 to 40 minutes to drive from Shinjuku to the designated spot in Higashi Ikebukuro. There were many parking meters on the east side of Ikebukuro Station, and the entire area, including the streets without meters, would be crowded on a Saturday afternoon. However, the specified location, along a main thoroughfare in front of Tokyo Credit Union, just so happened to be surrounded by office buildings, and on a weekend, both sides of the road would be relatively free of cars. Like last time, the spot chosen by the crime group made it clear that they were well-versed in the city's road conditions, but this second move in location seemed to indicate that they were stalling for time. The third page was a copy of the second email sent to CSHND. Arrive at Sunshine City by 12:25 p.m. Enter through South Entrance B and go to the second floor of the underground parking lot and park somewhere within the red sections 222 to 387. The driver should get out and leave the car with the key inside, take the cellular phone with him, and stand in front of the parking lot's east exit by 12:30 p.m. It took Goda a moment to fully grasp the import of these complicated instructions. Though he did not remember the exact numbers of the sections, his detective's mind immediately pictured Sunshine City's vast underground parking lot, one of the few of its kind in Tokyo, that could accommodate up to 1,800 vehicles. Since the facility was so large, it was divided into sections by color: red, blue, orange, yellow, and so on, but the parking aisles ran practically every which way like tiny capillaries, and the lot was notorious for getting drivers, unless they carefully confirmed their location on a map beforehand, completely lost. Without a prior run-through or advance preparations, tailing the driver or deploying officers to the area would be all but impossible. Goda immediately wondered if the police had had adequate time. He asked,
"What time did each party receive instructions about going to Sunshine City?"
"The email came in at 12:16 p.m. We made wireless radio contact with the driver of the Accord at 12:19 p.m. Those of us deployed near the credit union received word via wireless at 20 past. They expected the driver to be at Sunshine City's underground parking lot by 25 after. What could we have done in 5 minutes?"
"I understand."
"We booked it to the parking lot, but sure enough, once we were inside, it was a complete maze. Later, I asked the guy driving the Accord. He told me he couldn't find the section where he was supposed to go either. There was no cell phone reception underground, and while we were looking everywhere for the Accord, all of a sudden a fire broke out.
A fire?
It's in the evening edition. Goda quickly opened the evening paper. A large headline on the metro page read, Panic with 1,800 vehicles. Sunshine City underground parking lot engulfed in smoke. A malicious prank? The article continued. At around 12:30 p.m. on May 13th, a fire alarm went off in the central area of the second floor of the Sunshine City underground parking lot in Higashi Ikebukuro, and smoke soon filled the nearly 60,000 square meter garage. 40 fire trucks were dispatched immediately to the scene, and although they were unable to determine the source of the fire, at 12:40 p.m., they discovered a smoke grenade near the central eastern section 354. Firefighters continued to search the facility and found smoke grenades in sections 134, 273, and 438, for a total of 4 smoke grenades that were retrieved from the scene. During the 20 minutes or so from when the fire department arrived to when they completed their search, there was pandemonium within the facility, which was near capacity, as customers flooded the elevators and moving vehicles rushed toward exits, resulting in more than a dozen minor collisions.
We had no idea that the source of the fire was grenades, so when smoke started pouring into the parking aisles, all we could do was quickly retrieve the shopping bags full of cash from the Accord and get out of there ourselves. Thinking back now, I have no idea if the suspects were nearby or not. We did what we had to do before they made a move.
Hirase sounded genuinely nonplussed. Whatever the circumstances had been, the fact was that the police had been confounded by the suspect's instructions and, ultimately, had failed to capture them twice. Goda knew all too well the immense pressure of being on the scene at the front line, and yet that recognition was not enough to ease his own sense of exhaustion.
Goda-san, do you think the suspects truly intended to make the cash grab?
Hirase's expression was serious. Goda thought it would always have been difficult to make the cash grab in that particular lot. Judging by the specified parking spot, which the driver who received the instructions had trouble finding, the only conclusions to be drawn were either that the plan itself was flawed or the perpetrators had never intended to take the money in the first place. For the time being, though, Goda answered warily,
I'm in no position to make a judgment about that.
I believe the smoke grenades were set up by the suspects, but what do you think?
It's easy to imagine the suspects would have considered that inciting a fire panic would force the police to come running out to prioritize the safety of the cash. And if the suspects were the ones to set up the smoke grenades, then their intentions are unclear.
But the reality is, we were surrounded by smoke and had trouble locating the Accord. If it had taken us a little longer, they might have made off with the 700 million.
I can't make such judgments since I wasn't at the scene.
As expected, the look Hirase gave Goda revealed his pent-up frustration.
You're cleverer than ever, he mumbled.
Goda brushed off Hirase's comment.
The only thing I can tell you is that today, from noon on, Mr. Shiroyama and Chairman Suzuki showed no sign of having received any sort of report about what happened with the money exchange. Even on the ride home, there was no mention of it.
The company faces the possibility of getting taken for 700 million, and there's no update given to the president and the chairman? The matter doesn't even come up. What do you make of that?
All I can say now is, I don't understand it. I have yet to gather enough materials from the president's periphery to make a judgment.
It's your job to gather those materials.
I'm aware of that.
Goda opened the window.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.